That's correct. That's working.
I know, I just want to see some, something.
I turned the light on so it's brighter. Are you going
to
say something?
Yes, I am. I'll wait till somebody comes on. Jennifer, good evening. Give me a thumbs up if everything is okay with the picture and the sound. Setting up equipment. Give me a thumbs up. Is it okay? Thank you. We're gonna get started at 6 o'clock. So glad you're watching. Let a few more people get on board. While Mindy warms up the keyboard. Hey Matthew, what's going on, man? Glad you're watching. Give it a few more minutes, y'all. Let people get on line with us. Get a cup of coffee, get your Bibles, get your pens, your some paper. Got Mindy and Daniel here with me. Do a couple songs before we do our prayer meeting tonight, our Bible study. Keep an eye on the clock.
You should have the girls come say hi because everybody misses them.
Yeah, we got 1 minute. We can't.
So?
You get the girls.
Yeah.
You yell. You're the one that yells all the time anyway.
Shh. Just go around here. All right. We're almost ready to start, y'all. One more minute. Praise God. Let's start praising Him now. He inhabits the praises of His children. I want y'all to worship with us tonight. Pray that there's no distractions tonight. Pray that people don't call me till 7:15 tonight. While Mindy's playing, I'm going to pray us in. Then we're going to get started. Bow your heads with me if you would. Here we go. Father, we come in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. We come before you preparing to worship you in song. Your grace is amazing. So, Lord, help us. Fill us with your Holy Spirit as we worship you tonight. I pray that the church family would gather for prayer now. Remind people that we're doing this, and Lord, we're thankful for anybody that watches tonight. So glad they're joining us for worship, for Bible study, and for prayer. So thankful, Jesus, that your word is alive. So thankful for your faithfulness tonight. So thankful that you're on the throne. Worshiping with me, say this, Jesus, we love you, and we praise you. Hallelujah. Help us, Holy Spirit, as we worship. Help us to think of the words of the song. You're so awesome. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's children said amen. Go through one more time, guys.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy blood? amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
Thank you, Lord. Come on.
You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done.
Sometimes God wants Jeff just to hush and be still and know that he's God. I think we're all learning that right now, to just be quiet, to be still, and just to know that he is God. Worship with us.
And I'll let my words be few.
Jesus tonight. We're about to go into his word, and while we move the camera up here where I can see a little closer, we'll get started. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Isaiah. To Isaiah, bring it on, Andy. Give me just a minute to get adjusted here. This needs to raise up just a little bit, Melinda. Come on up with it. A little more. There we go. A little more. There you go. And this is the technology crew at work. Forgive me for the challenge of getting the camera up here, but we want to do some music with you. Hey, everybody. I didn't get to see who all was checking on at the beginning, so I don't know who's up above there in the comments, but I'm so glad you're watching. I hope you've got your Bible. I hope you've got a cup of coffee, some water. Obviously, this is a little more relaxed than at the church. If you spilled coffee at your house, I wouldn't even know it. And so, I guess we can drink coffee during these home sessions. Hopefully soon we'll be back at the church and doing what we do there. But for now, what I would encourage you to do is just get comfortable, maybe get in a quiet place. We're going to go to prayer meeting here shortly. But we are back in Isaiah. And those of you that attend Ensley First Baptist Church know that we started in a journey verse by verse through the book of Isaiah. It seems like 10 years ago, but it was well over a year ago, and we've made it all the way to chapter 19. We took a break for the resurrection season, and thankfully, we are picking right back up where we left off. So turn in your Bible to the prophet Isaiah, and we'll get started. God's judgment on Egypt, and this will be our introduction to this chapter. What I'd ask you to do, just so I can be worshiping and studying with you, is give me the thumbs up and the praying hands and the emojis. You know I like that feedback. Add comments, add scripture, and we can encourage each other. You'll be prompted to chime in here and there, but feel free to do that as the Holy Spirit leads. Let's pray one more time as we get ready to go to God's Word. Father, thank you. Thank you. We are so in love with you. Thank you for Mindy and Daniel helping me with the music there. And we do love you, Jesus. And your grace is amazing. We ask now that your Holy Spirit would teach us, that your Holy Spirit would fill your servant and everybody that's watching or will watch this. Please take over our hearts and teach us from your word, Lord. As we move through Isaiah, you know the caution that's in my heart, and I'm just a man. I really need your help. Please teach this Holy Spirit and take over so that this man cannot bring error but truth. And help us to apply this to what's going on in our world, in our country, for this time, for this season. Please help your servant, Jesus. I need you as always. It's in Jesus' name I pray. And all God's children said, amen. So hit an amen up there if you're praying with me. Here we go. We are breaking into chapter 19 of the book of Isaiah. And we're talking about Egypt. Before we get started with the actual text, type in a famous icon. Let's say a Hollywood, let's start with a Hollywood actor or actress. Type in a famous actor or actress. I'm going to go with Clint Eastwood. I can't type it because I'll knock the camera flying. But type in a famous actor or actress. It's just so famous that if you say the name, everybody knows who it is. Then type in a famous president of the United States of America. One that just, the first one that comes to your mind. I got a Tom Hanks. Type in the first president that you think is the most popular president of all time. This is not political. This is to make a point. Then, I know there's a little bit of a delay. Then, I got a Julia Roberts, Jessica Grimes. Then type in a great athlete. When I was a young man, seems like a couple of days ago, I used to love to watch Barry Sanders for the Detroit Lions run the football. He would put those moves on people and just leave them standing there, and he'd squirt out and he'd be down the field. He was one of my favorites. Name a famous Abraham Lincoln. I see that, Jessica. Name a famous athlete that some would call an icon. Then I want you to name a famous vocalist. A famous vocalist that if you said that name from any genre, if you said that name, wow, everybody would know who you're talking about. Put on there a famous vocalist, okay? Musician, maybe. Doesn't have to be a Christian artist for this purpose. Just trying to make a point. A famous musician. Thank you very much with the Elvis, Melinda. thank you very much. That was bad. I know. And finally, a famous world-renowned preacher. A famous world-renowned preacher that you've heard of, maybe growing up or in your lifetime or maybe even before that. A famous preacher that some may idolize. I'm having you put these names down there because we're going to wrestle with the fact, are they bigger in the minds and hearts of people than they should be? I see Billy Graham, Jane Ann. Good to see you, Jan. Billy Graham. You've heard of Billy Graham? Anybody heard of Billy Graham? Who's that guy? Yeah. Everybody's heard of Billy Graham, right? So, before the resurrection season, which we just came through, that said, we never stop thinking about what Jesus did for us on the cross and his resurrection. He's alive. Before that, in previous chapters, for the last 3 or 4 months, in previous chapters of Isaiah, we learn of God's judgment on certain nations. So you see, there was little nations around Judah, the southern kingdom, around Jerusalem. And God, Isaiah speaking about how he is dealing with those nations or would deal with those nations and why. And why? Let me come up just a little bit here with this. There we go. So one of those in chapter 13 and 14, does anybody remember? And if you're a good speller, if you're good at spelling for the sake of the others, you could put down chapter 13 and 14 of Isaiah. We dealt with Babylon. Then in chapters 15 and 16, we learn what Isaiah had to say about Moab. Chapter 15 and 16. Then in chapter 17, it was Syria and Israel, the northern kingdom. Remember at this time, the nation, well, the children of Israel, they were divided, the north and the south. 10 in the north, 2 in the south, I believe it is. And check me on all this because I'm a little rusty. That's why we're easing back into this. Chapter 19. Now we come to chapter 19 and you can type in Egypt. You can type in Egypt and that's where we're going today. And what I like to do, those of you that are new to this study, I like to look at these prophecies, to look at these issues from the Old Testament, and then ask the Holy Spirit to help us to self-evaluate. When I say us, I mean the United States of America. I mean Pensacola, Florida. I mean my house. And then I mean individually. So all of the precepts and the truths and the principles and the judgments and the prophetic work of the Old Testament is all there with good reason to help us grow in our faith to be more like Jesus Christ. That, if I could type, I'd put amen to that. I put amen to that, right? So if you're joining us for the first time or it's been a while, I encourage you to read over the next week, because we'll do this again next Wednesday, to read chapter 1 through chapter 18 of Isaiah. And even if you have been following and in our normal study at the church, we're going to do it again just to refresh your mind on everything we've covered thus far. Much of our study comes from some of the commentators. You can gather and do in-depth study on a wonderful website called blueletterbible.com. I highly recommend it for those of us that don't have a lot of money to get tons of commentaries. It's a good site where you can study in deep detail some of these issues and some of these chapters. In this chapter, the Lord presents both a prophecy against Egypt, against and for Egypt. So we'll see that. We will not get that far today. Like I said, we are just breaking into the chapter with some review. At the time of Isaiah's writing, the Egyptians were polytheists. So if you know what that is, and I'm going to do a pause on purpose to see if anybody will answer me. What is a polytheist? What is a polytheist? Polytheist. I'm waiting patiently with the delay. Isn't technology fantastic? I mean, we're shooting this up to some satellite to your house. Mindy's across the wall and there's a delay. What's a polytheist? Does anybody know? Anybody know? Many gods. Thank you, Jessica. There it is. Many gods. That's it. Multiple gods. So at the time of the writing, at the time Isaiah is hearing from the Lord, and this burden, as it's called, or judgment against, this prophecy against Egypt, they had many gods. And this is nothing new for Egypt. Nothing new. Now, though, however, and just cutting to the chase, to our time, Egypt, if I'm not mistaken, there's a whole bunch of Muslims there. So they may be monotheistic, however, wrong God, and he's not a God. And we know from the Word of God, Christians, there's only one God. God does not put up with idolatry. And you see where this is going today. We're dealing with the issue of idolatry, the things that we put above God, the things that we make more important in our hearts than God, it's not good. And I suggest all of us at some point in our life have been guilty of this sin. From the Old and New Testament, God rejects idolatry. And I could spend years just covering all those verses, but I'm just going to give you a couple tonight. So type in Exodus chapter 20. And verse 3. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 3. Of course, this is from the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. I don't think you can say it any simpler. any more concise. God makes it abundantly clear. We're to have no other gods but Him. Period. That is the triune God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the one God. Jesus told, I believe, Thomas, if you have seen the Father, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, I think is how he said it. You see this picture at Jesus' baptism of the Father's voice, the Holy Spirit of God, and Jesus, one God. The Lord our God is one God. We should love Him with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbor as ourself. Check out Mark 12, 30 and 31. One God, and there are no other gods. And God does not put up with idolatry in any of His children. He doesn't put up with it. And we're all potentially capable of going astray, going sideways. Even Christians, for sure, we can get where we have other things, possessions, or people that are more important to us than God. And that starts to play out in our heart, and God rejects that. And that's why we can go back to the Old Testament and gather from their mistakes, from their victories, so we can do a better walk, if you will, on the narrow road. So, I want you to type in material things. I've already done it on my iPad here, that people can value more than God. For example, if you find the money emoji and you push that, it'll come up. Do people value money more than God? Yes. And there's other ones. Go ahead. If you hit money or you type in money, it'll show you an emoji. Hit that emoji. Let's get a bunch of things that we should never put above God, but we do. Type them on there. I've got another one. What about automobiles or cars? You ever met somebody that thought so highly of their car, their vehicle was almost a god to them? What else? You don't have to just wait. I mean, you click in things or type in the name of something that people idolize, things above God. What is that one? I see some stuff coming. I see it coming. What about homes? There's a football. Old Robert Baker. Gonna get on some toes in the South, Robert Baker. Robert put that there, and I hesitate, but I agree with him 100%. If football is more important to you than Jesus, my friend, you have an idolatry problem, and I have been guilty. Not anymore. Jesus first. Amen? When it comes to football or sports, Jesus first. You hear that, Southerners? You hear that? I know how it is. I coach Little League football here. I know how it is. Missing Wednesday night prayer meet for practice. Not when Coach Jeff was coaching. We're going to church. Phone. Oh, Gary. Gary just busted out the phone. Yep. Wow. We're all under conviction. Are we under conviction? Give me a thumbs up if you're under conviction, and we'll be repenting with me tonight. Lord, forgive us for idol worship. Forgive us. What about boats, homes? You get the point. Matthew 6:33 teaches us what? Seek ye first. I can't get my voice on here. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Dun, 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 dun. And all these things shall be added unto you. Hit it with me. Alleluia, alleluia. Give me some harmony, Mindy. Yeah. Seek God first in His kingdom, in all seriousness. Seek God first in His righteousness. And all the other things that God wants us sometimes to have, but it's mainly the needs. It's the needs. Go to Romans 1 with me quickly. Romans chapter 1, we'll pick up in verse 21. However, I encourage you to read the whole chapter. In the Old Testament, we have pictures of idolatry, and in the New. And in the New, many, many places. Romans chapter 1, Verse 21. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became that his vain in their imaginations and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Verse 32. And changed the glory of the incorruptible God into the image made like to corruptible man, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator. That's exactly what idolatry is. The things that God created, we're not to worship. We're not to worship animals or planets or stars or other humans or ourselves. Let me read that again. And worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Isaiah, concerning Egypt in chapter 19, is going to be dealing big time with their idolatry. And it was nothing new under the sun for the Egyptians. Polytheists, excuse me. Isaiah, we break in now to verse 1 of chapter 19. And this is as far as we'll get tonight so we can get to prayer. The burden, the prophecy of Egypt. Behold, the Lord rideth upon a swift cloud and shall come into Egypt, and the idols of Egypt shall be moved. That is, scattered. That is, shaken. That is, removed. Have you ever heard of God knocking down false idols? Somebody say amen. They will be scattered, shaken, removed at his presence. And the heart of Egypt shall melt in the midst of it. God, in his time, deals with every nation that elevates false gods. Let me read that again. God, in his time, in his time is not our time. Oh, I'm learning that. His time is not our time, and the deal is his time is perfect, and he's long-suffering. If we ever needed a picture of his long-suffering ways, look at the United States of America, because if you compare what we are now with what happened with Sodom and Gomorrah, as Billy Graham taught, maybe there will be an apology. The thing is, we are in many ways rebelling in total idolatry and rebellion against God. And he is being long-suffering until every Christian comes into the fold. And we need to pray for, as I have been, for even more Nineveh time so we can keep reaching out with the gospel. But there's going to come a time when it is time out, time's up, game over, judgment comes. God's not going to put up with rebellion and idolatry forever. We need to pray. I'm hearing great stories of folks in different parts of the world, because of what's happening right now, being saved by the masses. And I give God praise for that. Maybe there is a train track, and on one train track there with this rebellion, judgment's coming, but yet on the other side of that track, as it's moving together, there are souls coming into the kingdom. And so maybe God is doing two things at once, which is his hands are never tied behind his back, but if they were, all he has to do is think it. Amen. He can make it happen. So we're praying for revival is the point of all that. But America's in trouble. We're in trouble. Let's just face it. I mean, there's so much idolatry. There's so much rebellion against God. So nations will not get away with that forever. If you look down through history, throughout time, through time gone by and past, you see many nations that rose up to become a superpower. I'm thinking of Babylon, I'm thinking of the Medo-Persians, I'm thinking, who else? Greece. You think of these nations that are no longer powers anymore, and you can't stick your finger in God's eye forever. He is not pleased when his children, listen carefully to this, the children of Israel, I'm talking also to born-again Christians right now in our setting, he is not pleased when his children follow pagan nations into idolatry. And America has plenty of Christian, born-again Christians in it, but our nation has been racing for many decades into paganism, into secular humanism, into idolatry, so much so that they write songs, Christians write songs about how God is not dead, he's truly alive. We know that. So when we follow the lead from the pagans, from those that are chasing idols, and when we don't look any different than the world, then we got a problem, Christians. We got a real problem when that's the case. We got a big problem. And when we follow the ways of the wicked that reject God, that deny God, that just build idols, then we need to repent. And I think that's what we need to do. I'm pretty confident. We need to repent. Repent means what? Type in, I'll give a delay while I get a drink of coffee. What does repentance mean? You can really define it with one word. One word. What does repent mean? It means turn. Turn from the sin, turn from the idolatry, and turn to Jesus Christ in repentance. If you're living in sin right now, if you're all about yourself, if you're all about this world, if you love this world, then the love of the Father is not in you. If you're not totally, radically in with Jesus, but you want part of the world to come with you, you got to repent. You got to radically follow Jesus Christ. This world's got nothing for you. All the bling, all the garbage that Satan dangles out there, all those carrots, they leave you empty. They leave the hole. They do not satisfy the heart. They do not satisfy the man. Help me, Holy Spirit. They do not satisfy. You will die miserable. The only way you're going to have that void filled, more Billy Graham for you tonight, is to ask the Holy Spirit of God to fill you with the power and the love of Jesus Christ. Be born again and be filled up with Jesus. Amen. And make him the only idol in your life. He's the only one you want to worship. He's is the word preeminent. He's excellent above everything. He's awesome above everything. And when you feel yourself starting to go sideways, the Holy Spirit will reel you back in, as he does me all the time, and keep Jesus number one. You see those big hands they wear at ball games, number one. My team's number one. Most of my teams are lousy anyway, so I don't really, wouldn't wear that anyway. But the thing is, you know who's number one? Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he doesn't accept idolatry of any kind. Back when God used Moses to deliver the children of Israel from their Egyptian slave masters, God brought judgment on all their false gods. So we're going back, Genesis, Exodus. Exodus 12, verse 12, type it in please, Exodus 12, verse 12. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night. Of course, this was the sacrifice of the lamb. We just covered Passover. By the way, Travis Tompkins, excellent job, excellent teaching. If you haven't seen Travis's teaching on the street page, on the Passover, you need to go watch that. Exodus 12, 12, for I will pass through the land of Egypt this night and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both men and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. And then he ends that verse by saying, I am, he's the only one. I am an I am statement. Remember Jesus, the I am. I am the Lord, he says. He brought judgment against the Egyptian gods back then, and they were up to it again. they were up to it again. And that just should show us, even if we have repented, even when we start following Jesus with all our hearts, just how quickly we can go back to putting other things above God. Letting our hearts elevate other things above God. And here's the thing. Here's how you can tell. Monitor, Holy Spirit, help us to monitor where our time is spent. How much time are you in God's Word? Are you putting other things above church attendance? Are you putting other things above worship? Are you putting other things above prayer? And pray that God would put a love in your heart to long, to thirst for His Word, to thirst for prayer, to thirst for Him instead of this garbage in the world. I mean, if you're spending, let's just get real tonight. If you're spending 8-9 hours a day, 3-4 hours a day, whatever it is, in front of a television, the God box, or just playing games on a cell phone, just monitor where your time is spent, where your money's spent, where your heart's at. And it'll help you see what's important in my life. And if there is need for repentance, then repent. Come back to Jesus. Tell Him I shouldn't be doing that. And then ask Him to help you have that deep love for Him so you'll long for Him more than anything or anyone. Somebody give me an amen or a thumbs up if any of that made sense. Each plague God sent their way was a judgment against each one of their false gods. I'm going to give you a couple examples here. Each one of their false gods, God brought judgment against that. And so let me get to my spot here. The first one, where is it? Here it is. The false god Ra, I guess is how you pronounce it. That false deity is just that, false, doesn't exist. I believe, and don't send me a bunch of mail. I just believe that's demonic. I believe those are demons that they're worshiping. But we're not, please don't. If you're new to our study, I'm a busy guy. Don't blow me up with emails. Let's face it. It was the sun they thought was a god. The sun in the sky. The ball of fire. The thing that keeps us warm here in Florida. The sunshine state. They thought that was a god. Well, that's just nonsense. God created the sun. They believed in the sun god, Ra. God hit them. What did He do? How did He deal with that? What did God do? God hit them with a plague of darkness. Exodus chapter 10, verse 21, mark it in there. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand toward heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, even darkness which may be felt. That's always been an interesting statement to me, because when you're involved in spiritual warfare, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 18, check out the armor of God. When you're involved in spiritual warfare and you've been a born-again Christian for a little while and you know what that spiritual warfare is all about, you can feel that darkness. It's hard to explain. It's a spiritual warfare. But God pulled away His light. He stopped the sun from shining, and they felt the evil that they had invested themselves in all around them. Isn't that something? God dealt with that false god and showed that He created the sun. He created sun, moon, stars. He created everything, and He can do with it what He wants. See Joshua. Joshua needed Him to stop the sun. God took care of that one too. Jesus is Lord over the sun that He created. John chapter 1, verse 1 through 3, moving quickly. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Who's the Word? Somebody type in Jesus. And the Word was God. We're back to the I Am, and He is Jesus. The same was in the beginning with God. Now watch this. All things were made by Him. Settled. And without Him was not anything made that was made. God, the Lord Jesus Christ, He's the Creator. He's the creator. We worship Jesus, not the ball of fire in the sky. But the Egyptians, they were worshiping all kind of junk. Frogs. Remember that one? What else? Cows. The Nile. The fish. They were doing just like we read in Romans chapter 1. They were worshiping created things. We don't do that, though, preacher. Hold on. Let me give you another quick example. Example number 2, that is, their false god, Osiris, believed to be the giver of life. We know who the giver of life is. It ain't Osiris. Osiris doesn't exist. Again, I believe that's a demon. Believed to be the giver of life and the deity of the Pharaoh himself. God took the life, remember, on that Passover night, he took the life of every what? Firstborn. God is the giver of life. He gives and he takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Pharaoh was not a god. He learned that quick. He could not stop the plagues. He could not stop the loss of his very own firstborn son. There was another only begotten son that died and became sin for us. What was his name again? God took the life of every firstborn. Osiris couldn't give life. Osiris doesn't exist. Osiris isn't a god. Jesus is God. Period. Exodus 12:29, and it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. In Isaiah's time, when this is being penned, when the Holy Spirit is working through Isaiah, their idolatry continued. Their polytheism continued. Their many gods continued, though God had dealt with them. Now, historians and commentators believe God has judged the Egyptians for idolatry on multiple occasions. And feel free to get deeper and study on that. For our purposes, so we can bring this full circle, so we can cross back over that bridge of time and space to 2020, and let's evaluate the United States of America. Let's compare the United States of America and our situation with Egypt as we break into chapter 19, of Isaiah. Let's compare that with now, the past polytheism with the United States of America. Does the vast majority of Americans, and note those words, vast majority, does the vast majority of Americans worship frogs, fish, cows, the sky, the moon, the stars? I suggest, and this is just me talking to you here, that no, not the vast majority. I don't think so. So then we're good, right? We're good to go then. We're okay then. I would say to that, wrong. We're not good at all. And let me tell you why. Let me tell you what I think the vast majority of people in this country are worshiping, and it ain't Jesus. Let me suggest our sin of idolatry is man worship, mankind, self-worship. When Satan told Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, pre-fall, just when you break into Genesis chapter 3, what did he tell them? That they could be as gods. Gods. And they bought the lie. And every time we put ourselves above Jesus, every time we put another human being, whether it's a preacher, an athlete, a musician, a politician, let me tell you something. There are people that worship Barack Obama, and there are people that worship Donald Trump. You know who I worship? Jesus Christ. Those are just men assigned by God, and we should pray for them. We do. but they're just men. We're not supposed to hate them. We're supposed to pray for them. But they're not gods. And so there shouldn't be these cults of worshiping human beings. We shouldn't worship preachers. We shouldn't elevate preachers. We should elevate Jesus. Preachers are under shepherds. They're supposed to be servants. We shouldn't elevate man. We have seeped into this mindset in America of secular humanism, where men and women have elevated themselves and bought the lie, just like Adam and Eve did, that we can be more important than Jesus, more important than God. And that is dangerous, and it is just as much idolatry as the Egyptians were involved in, period. It's dangerous, and we need to repent. This country needs to repent and come back to Jesus Christ, race back like prodigal sons and daughters that have been playing in Egypt is a picture of the world, just like Babylon is. This picture of the cesspool of the world, we need to come running back because the pig pen's got nothing for us but slop and sin. We need to come racing back to the Father, and He will run to us. But if we don't repent and turn from that and come back, expect the hammer to fall soon. Man worship won't cut it with Jesus. It won't. It won't. On that note, let's go to the Lord in prayer. As I've said in previous weeks, and I am looking forward to getting back to the church, but as I've said in previous weeks, type in your prayer request underneath, and that way our administrative assistants, both Pat Patterson and Alice Canny, can add that to our church prayer page. And also take note, if you're just watching this for the first time, the Holy Spirit has put on my heart to get up every morning, and we are praying for a shorter session at 5:30 a.m. You are invited to join prayer with us Monday through Friday at 5:30. What we need to do on Wednesday nights is get these prayer requests on there. People with cancer, Jesus can heal. We believe that. We pray for that. He doesn't always. I know that. He brings some people to heaven. But He will heal when it's His good pleasure and will to do so. Pray for the sick. Pray that COVID-19 would come to its good end. Pray for those that have it. I want you to lift up. Mindy, did you already put her name? First names only, like Mindy said. Kayla has COVID-19. She's become a friend of ours. Pray for Kayla. She has COVID-19. There was another one today that Kenny had mentioned. Mindy, put that name up there too. And start praying for people. Pray for Chris Floyd. Oh, I've said his first name, but he's a member of the, his last name. He's a member of the church, and we know who he is. Chris. Okay. Craig has COVID-19. Pray for the prodigal sons and daughters. Pray for the lost. Pray for the president. Pray for Israel. Just start putting your prayer request on there. And here we go. Bow your head with me. Here we go. Father in heaven, we come to you in Jesus' name. We enter to your gates with thanksgiving, into your courts with praise. Lift up your hands if you can, and let's worship Him. Say this with me. Jesus, we love you and we praise you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Help me, Holy Spirit, to pray. Help me to pray and to praise you. Help us, Lord, as we seek your face. If we seek you with all of our heart, we'll find you. Help me, Lord, just to focus on you, not anything around me. Please keep distractions away. Pray with me with all your heart, church. Just lift up people. Lift up your family. Lift up your friends. Lift up this situation, that God would use it in an amazing way. Come on, pray. Pray with me now. Come on, let's take it across the end zone. Let's get this touchdown for Jesus. Let's pray, pray, pray. Want to coach us up? Let's pray, let's pray, let's pray. Let's seek Jesus. He is our coach, our captain, our everything. Jesus, please help us as we pray. Lord, we lift up first off tonight the sick. As we've mentioned names, as you see the names scrolling, you pray for the sick. You pray for those with cancer. The word of God says in Isaiah, matter of fact, that it is by your stripes, Jesus, that we are made whole. And Lord, you went to the cross for us. You took our sickness, our shame, our sin. You became sin for us. We pray that you would please forgive us and heal the sick, Lord. We pray for the sick. We pray, Jesus, that through the sickness, many souls would come to glory. They'd call on Jesus for salvation. Lift up the sick. Lift up the sick. We pray, Jesus, tonight for the... Listen, wait, before I leave. If you are sick and you are listening to this, I don't know who you are, but listen, I want to pray right now. Say this with me. Say, Jesus, please heal me. If you need to be saved, call on him, say you're sorry of your sins, and call on him to save you. Say, Jesus, please save me, and he will. Romans 10:13. If you're a Christian and you're sick, say, Jesus, I am a sinner. Please heal my infirmity. Please heal whatever it is. Say whatever it is. Jesus, please heal me. Then say this, by your stripes, I am made whole. You are just quoting scripture. It's not a magical formula. It is calling on Jesus for healing. Lord, we lift up tonight the prodigal sons and daughters, and this country is full of them. People that have sold out to this world that want nothing to do with you, Lord. People we love, people in our families, people we want to come home. Jesus, people that used to go to church and worship you but no longer do. Pray for them by name. If you put a name on here, first name only, please. And Jesus, please draw them back to yourself. Do whatever it takes. Even if that involves heartache, even if that involves pain, their eternal soul, their restoration is far more important than anything this world could possibly offer. And on that note, since we are learning of idolatry tonight, every one of us, if you've been involved in some sort of idolatry where you put something above Jesus, I'm going to confess one, my phone. I'm turning to you, Jesus. If there's something that you're putting above Jesus Christ, then confess it and he'll forgive you. His word says, if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. Confess your sin tonight and he will forgive you. If you're involved in idolatry, if you're putting other things above Jesus, repent of it. Turn from it. Lord, give us a love for you more than anything. Bring us back to our first love, which is you. I'm speaking to Christians. Bring us back. We know judgment starts in the house of God. Forgive us, Jesus. Forgive this country. Forgive us when we buy into the garbage of this country. Forgive us when we're so caught up in other things we forget you. Forgive us, Lord. Help us to love you and long for you and thirst for you more than anything or anyone. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us, Lord. We pray tonight, oh Holy Spirit, please help me. We pray tonight for the lost. If you know somebody that if they died right now, they've never called out to Jesus for salvation, they would die in their sin, die in their idolatry. They would die in their cesspool of sin, and they would go to hell. And the Bible teaches very clearly there is a literal hell. We pray, Jesus, that you would save their soul, that you would send someone to them, that you would send these listeners to them, that we would open up our mouths, and that we would share that Jesus loves them and doesn't want them to go to hell. Please, Jesus, draw them back. Draw them to you. Open their hearts and their minds, their eyes to know that they need a Savior and his name is Jesus. Help them to see that they are involved in sin and need to repent from it. And please, Jesus, save the lost. Pray for them by name right now. The time is short. We don't have forever on this side. Pray for the lost that God would save them and pray against Satan who's trying to steal the word away. We rebuke you, Satan, in the name of Jesus Christ, for greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. We submit ourselves, therefore, to God. We reject you. We resist you, Satan. Put your armor on. Put the faith on, and you share the gospel. You share the gospel with the people that are going to hell, and then you've done what you do. Then you pray that God will do whatever it takes to save those souls. Pray for the lost. Don't stop praying and take and put feet to those prayers and use your mouth and use your heart and you pray for the lost. Now we pray, Jesus, tonight for this country. Lift them up. You lift up former presidents. And so there's no confusion, as I've already said many times. You pray for Barack Obama, for Joe Biden. You pray for Donald Trump and Mike Pence. You pray for all of them because God wants us to. Pray for peace in Israel and peace in the United States of America and peace in troubled nations that the gospel would go through. Pray for China that the gospel would break through. Pray for all born-again religious denominations. Pray for the Methodists and the Presbyterians and the Baptists and pray for the non-denominational churches. You pray for pastors. The pastors would get on fire for God in this time, that they would preach the word of God, that they would share with clarity, that the Holy Spirit would just fill us and that we would just unload it, unload the gospel on Satan. We pray for mass revival. Pray for the preachers. Type the name of preachers. Type the name of churches. Pray for my wife. Pray for me. Pray for Ensley First Baptist Church. Pray for the ministries of our church, Ensley First Baptist Church. Pray for streets. Pray, Robert, for your team. Pray for the contractors. Mindy, pray for the praise team. Pray, church. Pray for the children's ministry. Pray for every aspect of the church, those that work behind the scenes. Pray for your church. Pray for, if you go to a different church, you pray for your church. Pray right now that the body of Christ would come alive and on fire in this time. What a time to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus, we pray. Oh, we pray that you'd hear us tonight and that you would help us to stay focused on you, eyes on you, and not this world. Thank you for hearing our prayer tonight. Thank you for helping your servant. I thank you, Jesus, for all the people that have watched, and we'll be careful to give you all the praise, honor, and glory. Now, if you're new to us, the church family knows what we're about to do, but if you're new to us, we sing Victory in Jesus at the end of every service. And the reason being, because over 16, 17 years ago, when I replaced the pastor that was there, Pastor Bill Estes, an awesome man of God, his wife had leukemia, and the church prayed that she would be healed. She was healed completely. And so they sing Victory in Jesus at the end of the service, and we continue with that fantastic tradition because there is victory in Jesus, because he died for us, he became sin for us, he died, he rose again the third day, and whoever calls on his name, Romans 10:13, if you have never done that, just call on Jesus, you will be saved. Here we go. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Sing it. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Come on, come on. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Love y'all. Love y'all so much. If you want to keep praying with us, please pray through the night. And I'll be back here, same bat channel, same place, the Ensley Facebook page, tomorrow morning at 5:30 a.m. for about a 10 or 15 minute prayer to start the day. Share this, share those prayer meetings, and let's all pray together, and let's keep it going for Jesus. We'll be back in the church soon enough, but we got work to do now. Keep your chin up, eyes on Jesus. This is Pastor Jeff. I love y'all, and we are out.